presents the unabridged recording of The Court Reporter, written by Jamelle Wells and read by Jamelle Wells. The dedication reads, "For my mother Cecilia, who died on the 12th of September, 2016. Introduction. In January 2016, my mother Cecilia found out she had terminal cancer and came from her home in country New South Wales to stay with me for a while in Sydney for treatment while my father Alan stayed at home. I was covering the Sydney siege inquest. She spent long days on her own, watching me standing in the gutter outside the John Madison Tower court building in Goulburn Street in the CBD, doing live television crosses on the ABC News Channel and listening to my radio news stories and live program crosses on ABC Radio Sydney. Her palliative care drugs made her anxious, and she was petrified of dying. One night when I got home, she was so worked up, she was pacing back and forth in my house. 'Mum, I don't think you're going to die tonight,' I said to her, and got her into the car to go out for a drive to try to take her mind off things. As we pulled out of the car park, she settled a bit. 'I'm proud of you,' she said, 'but I've never seen where you work. Can you show me some of the courts in the city?' So we spent hours driving around the CBD, past the ABC at Ultimo, past the John Madison Tower Court Complex, past the Downing Centre Courts and Central Local Court in Liverpool Street, past the Law Courts building in Queen Square, the St James Road Court, the King Street Courthouse and Darlinghurst Courthouse, past Glebe Coroner's Court on Parramatta Road, and past the new ICAC building on Elizabeth Street and the old one on Castlereagh Street. I explained to her that these were just a few of the courts I'd been hanging around for almost a decade, and we didn't have time to go out to all the other courts in the suburbs. We were on our way back to my inner west house when she said, 'Where does Eddie Obeid live?' She'd seen photos of the former Labor Minister's Hunters Hill home in the news for many years. So we went past there too and ate a Choc Top ice cream in a park overlooking the water near Hunters Hill. Mum had calmed right down by now. 'You might be sad when I die, so you need to keep busy,' she said. 'You could write a book about some of your adventures in the courts and all the people you've seen and talked to.' So that is what I've done. Over the past decade, I've covered hundreds of different court cases and I've filed more than 10,000 radio news stories alone. That figure doesn't include thousands of live radio and television crosses. I've been closely involved with the ABC News Channel since it started in 2010, doing live television crosses on major court cases, and I've worked with ABC Online from the very start, covering court stories. I've covered so many cases, I actually forget I've covered some of them, and I'm only reminded of them when I come across videos and recordings of my work or stories online. Not always remembering some of the detail of the more confronting things I've covered is probably a good thing, because like a doctor or police officer, you can't carry it all around with you, and you need to switch off sometimes and keep a certain distance and objectivity to get the job done. I've had moments in court when the public gallery has erupted into fits of laughter, fights have broken out or people have collapsed with grief. I've done stories about horrific stabbing, shooting and beheading murders. I've covered a case involving a member of the Malat family, another involving Bush fugitive Malcolm Naden, and the murder trials of former water polo champion Kelly Lane, ex-chauffeur Gordon Wood, and Sydney man Jeffrey Gillam, who was jailed for life after being convicted of murdering his parents Helen and Stephen Gillam in their Warranora home in Sydney's south, but was later acquitted on appeal when new evidence was found. I've covered cases involving politicians, including the court case between former Speaker Peter Slipper and his ex-staffer James Ashby, and cases involving the Health Services Union, senior police, including former New South Wales Crime Commission investigator Mark Standen, who was jailed for conspiring to import drugs. One federal court case I covered involved a public servant who sued for compensation after injuring herself having sex in a motel her employer had booked for a work trip in country New South Wales. The woman claimed that a glass light fitting that came away from the wall hit her in the face, injuring her nose and mouth and causing a psychiatric adjustment disorder. She won the federal court case, But then the government's workplace safety body ComCare appealed to the High Court and won, so the compensation she thought she was entitled to never eventuated. The round has taken me into court for cases involving celebrities, such as the late Leonard Cohen, Gina Reinhart and her family, and ex-Hey Dad television star Robert Hughes. I've covered grubby, horrible cases involving sex offenders, husband killers, wife killers, child killers, petty thieves and very bad drivers. There are cases I've followed in and out of several court jurisdictions and appeals that have resulted in acquittals or shorter jail sentences. Inquests into the death and disappearance of people whose families still grieve have been part of my job, including the long-running Sydney Siege inquest and inquests into the cruise ship death of Diane Brimble, television newsreader Charmaine Dragoon, tasered Brazilian student Ladicio Curti, and the Quakers Hill nursing home mass murders. I've covered terrorism trials, bikie trials, sexual harassment and animal cruelty cases, and a case involving a woman who killed her children with rat poison and another who jumped to her death after doing a self-help course. The long-running church sex abuse inquiries, ICAC inquiries, copyright matters, industrial court matters, land and environment court matters, defamation and copyright cases and committal hearings have all been part of my job. I've been chased, spat on, threatened with physical violence, stopped from entering a court and injured on the job, but have, on the flip side of all that, had the incredible reward of connecting with audiences and being in court for some of the biggest moments in New South Wales politics. The courtroom presents life in all its complexities, and it can provide the most amazing and addictive theatre. The case itself is often a subplot for all the dynamics and relationships in a public gallery. I wrote this book to fulfil my promise to my mum, and it's dedicated to her memory. I hope that you find the courts and all the colourful stories and characters as interesting to read about as I did to witness. Chapter 1, Judgment Day. On the 13th of February 2017, Robert Z was given five life sentences for murdering five members of his wife's family by bashing them to death as they lay sleeping in their beds in the quiet, leafy, middle-class Sydney suburb of North Epping. Just a month earlier, a jury found him guilty in a majority 11-1 verdict when it couldn't reach a unanimous one. The case was intriguing and frustrating at the same time for me because it had dragged on for so long. I'd been following it since Z's arrest in 2011 and his subsequent committal hearing and the aftermath. This short and rather frail man always had a calm demeanour in court. He looked no different than the other suited professionals on their way to work in the CBD each day. He was a trained ear, nose and throat surgeon who was born in China and came to Australia in 1999. Z owned a restaurant in Melbourne before moving to Sydney, where he was mostly not working. In 2011, he was charged with murdering his wife's brother, Norman Lynn, 45, Mr. Lynn's wife, Lily, 43, and their two sons, Henry, 12, and Terry, 9, and Lily's sister, Irene, 39. Their bodies were found early on Saturday, the 18th of July, 2009, in their home, after Norman Lynn didn't show up to open his news agency. Hours earlier, they'd been at their usual Friday night family dinner with Norman Lynn's parents at Merrylands in Sydney's West. According to police, Norman Lynn was well-liked and he had no known enemies. At first, police thought the murders might have resulted from some sort of gang rivalry or from an unpaid debt. The murders had shocked Sydney because they were so violent and gruesome, and at first it was assumed they'd been committed by a number of people. Bloody footprints were found at the crime scene house, with blood spattered over the walls, the ceiling and furniture. Robert Z was questioned by police soon after the murders. 2 years later, following a secret police operation that included months of video surveillance in his home and the questioning of his wife Kathy Lynn by the New South Wales Crime Commission, he was charged. The Crown case was that Robert Z crept into Norman Lynn's home in Boundary Road, which was only about 300 metres from Z's own home in Beck Street, late at night, let himself in with a key, turned the power off, and bashed the family to death in their beds with a hammer-like object. The prosecution alleged that Robert Z drugged Kathy Lynn that night, but in sentencing him, Justice Fullerton said she could not be totally sure of that, and Kathy Lynn may have just remained asleep when he snuck out. The prosecutor argued that Z was motivated by jealousy and bitterness because he thought his wife's parents favoured Norman Lynn and that he wanted the family out of the way because of his sexual motive involving Brenda Lynn, the oldest child, who'd been overseas at the time of the murders. Z denied committing the murders, and his defence case was that he had no motive to kill a family because he got on with them. After Z was found guilty in January 2017, the Supreme Court released some of the exhibits that had been shown to the trial jury. They included horrific and graphic photos of the crime scene that included blood on walls, power points, door handles, and even on ceiling light fittings. There were photos of the children's room with their blood all over the walls. Prosecutors had also argued that a stain found on Robert Z's garage floor, labelled Stain 91, contained the DNA of four of his victims, and the jury saw police surveillance footage of Z destroying shoeboxes in his house after officers found bloody footprints at the crime scene. The jury was told that when Z and Kathy arrived at the Lynn family home on the morning of the 18th of July 2009, Z told his wife not to look at one body that he couldn't possibly have seen from where he was standing and that he must have known beforehand where that body was. The court also released the frightening 000 emergency call Kathy Lynn made after finding the bodies. Z had driven off and left her at the Lynn house on her own, probably so he could get rid of the murder weapon and pick Kathy's parents up from the nearby suburb of Merrylands and tell them about the deaths. Norman Lynn's body wasn't found by police first for some time because it was hidden under a doona, yet Z told some of the first police officers at the scene there were five bodies in the house, not the four that they first thought were there. The jury was told about a phone call that Z later made to tell a detective he really meant four or five bodies to try to cover his tracks. Z stood trial four times, with the first trial starting in 2014. That first trial was aborted after new evidence was found, and the second trial was aborted after the judge, Justice Peter Johnson, became unwell. A third trial that ran for a massive 9 months and was presided over by Justice Elizabeth Fullerton ended in a hung jury. Senior Crown Prosecutor Mark Tedeschi QC led the first three trials. The fourth, which was led by Prosecutor Tanya Smith, ran for just over 6 months. Z did not give evidence at any of them. I was covering Z's sentence in February 2017 for the ABC News Channel. Knowing it would be a big story for the day, our senior chief of staff in the Sydney newsroom, Simon Santo, had sent other reporters with me to cover it for other ABC News services. I got to the Supreme Court building in King Street an hour early to suss things out and check in with my camera crew, who arrived a few minutes after me. We found a good position on the footpath to set up for my live television crosses. It was not too close to the building so as not to get moved on by the court officers, but close enough to see it in the background. We tried our best to set up out of the wind. Other media outlets were staking out their own positions. One cameraman had a fold-up camping chair to sit on. Two women, one with shopping bags and the other with a big white envelope under her arm, stopped and asked me what everyone was there for. "The sentence for Robert Z," I told them. "The guy found guilty of murdering the Lynn family." "I remember that. It's terrible," said one. "Sydney's getting worse." They moved off towards Macquarie Street. As all the lawyers, family members and court watchers started trickling towards the court foyer, the television crews got footage of all the Lynn family members and the prosecutor and the legal teams coming in. A car came past us down King Street and slowed down as someone shouted out the window at the media pack, "You fucking parasitic vermin!" We're accustomed to these types of greetings from some members of the public, No one from the media pack even batted an eyelid or turned around to see who it was. We were too busy working. Kathy Lynn arrived wearing a cardigan and with a female Salvation Army court volunteer. Then the very emotional Lynn family grandparents arrived, carrying photos of their slain loved ones. One of the last people to arrive with some of her friends was the surviving and oldest Lynn.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.